Yes, students, so we are going to start our unit number 3, which is 2 degrees of freedom systems, undamped vibration. This is the first lecture for this unit number 3, and we are going to see this lecture number 18, that is free undamped longitudinal vibration of 2 degrees of freedom systems. So this is the first lecture of your unit number 3. So we are starting our unit number 3, that is first topic in that free undamped longitudinal vibration of 2 degree of freedom system. Now up till now, or unit number 1 and unit number 2, that is from lecture 1 to lecture 17, we have seen the single degree of freedom system. In that, there are various types of vibration. We have seen longitudinal, torsional, transverse, free, forced, damped, undamped. All these types of vibration we have seen in first unit. Now, in this third unit, we are going to see the free undamped longitudinal vibration as well as torsional vibration for 2 degrees of freedom system. So we will start with our first topic, that is free undamped longitudinal vibration for 2 degrees of freedom system. Now consider a spring mass system. Only spring mass system is there because it is undamped system, so there is no damper. So remaining two mathematical model terms, that is one is spring and another is mass. So consider a spring mass system having 2 degrees of freedom system, having 2 degrees of freedom as shown in figure. So this is the figure. So it consists of two masses, that is M1 and M2. Now this M1 mass, it is displaced by a displacement X1, and this M2 mass is displaced by displacement X2. There are three springs given in this diagram or in this figure. So first spring having stiffness K1, second spring having stiffness K2, and third spring is there having stiffness K3. Now the K1 spring is, one end of this K1 spring is attached to a fixed support and other end to the M1. Similarly, K2 spring, the one end is attached to the M1 and other end is attached to the M2. And for K3, one end is attached to M2 and other end is attached to the fixed support. So this is your equilibrium position or mean position. So there are two masses, so there are two mean position or two equilibrium position. So this is first mean position for mass M1, and this is second mean position or equilibrium position for mass M. Now, before analyzing this system, that is, this consists of 2 degrees, that is two independent coordinate, that is X1 is one coordinate and X2 is another coordinate, which are required to specify this system. So there are two coordinates. So this is two degrees of freedom system. So before analyzing this system, some assumptions to be made. So we'll start with that assumptions. So your first assumption, while made in 2 degrees of freedom system, so your first assumption is the masses are constrained to move in the direction of spring axis only. So if spring axis is this vertical axis, so masses will move only in vertical axis. No other axis mass will be moved. So this is first assumptions which is made in the analysis of 2 degrees of freedom system. Then second is the spring are weightless. The spring are weightless. So the weight of spring or mass of spring we are going to neglect. And the third important assumption is that is x2 should be greater than x1. Now what are the x1 and x2? Where x1 is the displacement of mass m1 and x2 be the displacement of mass m2. So your assumption is x2 should be greater than x1 means the displacement of mass m2 should be greater than the displacement of mass m1. So that is x2 should be greater than x1. So these three assumptions is very much important while analysis of this 2 degrees of freedom system. So we will take second diagram, that is your displaced position. So this M1, this is your original position or mean position or equilibrium position. Now from this, the mass is displaced in downward direction through and distance x1. So this is distance x1. So this is first displaced position. So this is M1 equilibrium position and this is M1 displaced position. Similarly, this is M2 is the, so this line or this equilibrium position is the equilibrium position for mass M2, and from this equilibrium position this mass M2 is displaced by a displacement x2 in vertically downward direction. Only difference is that the value of x2, that is the displacement x2, is greater than the displacement x1. So this displacement is greater. So this is your equilibrium position for mass M2 and this is your displaced position for mass M2 and this is distance x2. Now because of that, this k1 is in tensile condition, this k2 is also in tensile condition, but the spring k3, it is in compressed condition because in both sides there is fixed support. So if these two springs are in tensile condition and the moment of mass m1 and m2 is in downward direction, so your k3 spring, it is moving, it is in compressed direction. Now we have to draw the free body diagram for two masses separately, that is mass m1 and mass m2. So we will start with free body diagram. So first, free body diagram for mass m1. Now we know that if the displacement is in downward direction, then so displacement x1 is in downward direction, so velocity x1 dot, it is also in downward direction, and acceleration x1 double dot, it is also in downward direction. All these three, displacement, velocity and acceleration of mass m1, that is x1, x1 dot and x1 double dot, are in downward direction. So there are only two forces, one is inertia and another is spring force. So in this M1, there are two springs are acting. One is K1 and second K2, and M1 is inertia force. So what will be happen? Now, acceleration is downward direction. So inertia force is nothing but the force into acceleration. Mass into acceleration. Inertia force is mass into acceleration. So M into X1 double dot. So mass is M1. So M1 into X1 double dot. This is inertia force of mass M1, that is M1 X1 double dot, and direction is opposite to the acceleration. acceleration is in downward direction, so it is opposite. Now, what will be the second condition? Spring force. Now, for K1 spring, the displacement is in downward direction. So, spring force, that is K1 into X1, it is opposite to the displacement. So, this is K1 into X1, which is opposite to the displacement. Now, in tensile, the generally forces are in outward direction, but the spring force we are taking as opposite direction. So, at tensile condition, these two forces are, the direction of these two forces are like this, spring force. So, first, and this is for mass M2. So, this is the, now, what is the displacement for this spring? Because mass M2, this spring is connected to mass M2 and M1. This spring, that is K2, is connected to mass M2 and another one is connected to mass M1. So, what will happen? So, total displacement for this K2, it is nothing but the X2 minus X1. This is the total displacement for this spring only. What is that? X2 minus X1. So, this spring force, that is K2 into X2 minus X1. So, this is the spring force. Now, this spring force is acting for both masses, that is mass M1 also and mass M2 also. So, this is the spring force for both. Now, for mass M2, again, the displacement is in downward direction. So, again, velocity is also in downward direction and your acceleration also is in downward direction. So, acceleration is in downward direction. So, your inertia force M2 into X2 double dot, it is in upward direction. So, mass into acceleration. The mass is M2 and acceleration is X2 double dot. And this force, it is like in this, that is K2, X2 minus X1. And your third force, now this is compressed. So, it is opposite direction. So, because of this compression of spring is there, so your force is in opposite direction. If there is tension, then your force will be like this. But there is a compression because these all these three springs and two masses are confined between two fixed support. So, because of that, this spring is in compression direction. So, your direction is changed. Now, this is the free body diagram for masses M1 and M2. So, what are the forces acting on that? So, there are only two types of force. One is spring force and other is the inertia force. So, from FBD of masses M1 and M2, we can write two differential equation of motion because there are two masses, there are 2 degrees of freedom. So, there will be a 2 differential equation. If there is one mass, then there will be a one FBD and there will be only one differential equation. If there are two masses, then there will be a 2 differential equation for separate mass M1 and M2. So, what will be the differential equation from first body diagram, that is first free body diagram of mass M1, we can say that this inertia force plus this external force. So, K1 X1 is another external force, K2 X2 is another external force. So, we are taking this direction as positive, that is direction of inertia force, that is upward direction is positive. So, this direction is positive, this direction is positive and this direction is negative. Similarly, for M2 also, the direction of inertia force is positive. So, upward direction is positive. Again, this direction is positive, this force direction and this force direction is also positive. So what will be the, according to the equilibrium method or D'Alembert's principle, we can write for mass m1, for mass m1, that is m1 x1 double dot plus k1 x1 minus, because this is in downward direction, so minus k2 into x2 minus x1. Now we can write this equation, we can simplify it as, now we can multiply this term k2 into x2, and this minus k2 into x2 becomes minus k2 x2, and this minus k2 into minus x1, that becomes plus k1 k2 x1. So again this term is same, so m1 x1 double dot, again this k1, it is plus k1, so this is plus k1. Now there is also x1 term, so minus k2 into minus x1, so that is minus minus plus, so plus k2 into x1, and minus k2 into x2 is equals to 0. So this is simplified equation, that is equation number 1. Similarly, there is another equation, so that is m2 x2 double dot plus, now if we see, this is positive, this is also positive, this is also positive, all these three forces are positive, so what will happen, so your m2 x2 double dot plus k2 plus k3 x2, sorry, m2 x2 double dot plus k2 x2 minus x1 plus k3 x2 is equals to 0. Now take common term of x2, now k2 plus k3 is also plus, so k2 plus k3 into x2 minus this k2 into minus x1, that become minus k2 x1 is equals to 0. So these are the two differential equation, that is simplified two differential equation. So this is your first differential equation, that is m1 x1 double dot plus k1 plus k2 into x1 minus k2 x2 is equals to 0. This is first differential equation, and your second differential equation is m2 x2 double dot plus k2 plus k3 into x2 minus k2 x1 is equals to 0. So these are the two differential equation for two masses or 2 degrees of freedom system. Now there is again another assumption is there. Now assuming this mass m1 and m2 execute harmonic vibration at frequency omega, and the solution for x1 and x2 under steady state conditions are, so this solution under steady state conditions is given by, so first condition, that is solution of x1, displacement x1 is equals to capital x1 sine of omega t, and x2 is equals to capital x2 sine of omega t, because this is a harmonic vibration. So for SHM, we know that for SHM this x1 is equals to x1 sine of omega t and x2 is equals to x2 sine of omega t, where x1 and x2 are the amplitude of vibration at frequency omega of two masses m1 and m2 at steady state conditions. So we have to put the value of x1, x2 and x1 double dot and x2 double dot in equation number 1 and equation number 2, because equation number 1 consists of x1 double dot term, x1 term and x2 terms. Similarly, the equation number 2 consists of x2 double dot, x2 term and x1 term. So already x1 and x2 are, this x1 is equals to capital x1 sin of omega 2, x2 is equals to capital x2 sin of omega. Now we have to find out x1 double dot and x2 double dot. So for that we have to equate the differentiate this equation 3 and equation 4 twice. So after differentiating equation 3 and 4 twice, so what will happen? So if we differentiate this equation twice, so that becomes d2x1 upon dt square, that is nothing but the x1 double dot, that is acceleration, is equals to, now sine's derivative is cos omega t and derivative of omega t is omega. Again, cos omega t is, derivative of cos omega t is minus sine omega t, and derivative of omega is again omega t is again omega. So that becomes minus x1 omega square sine of omega t. Similarly, again double differentiating this equation number 4, so we get x2 double dot is equals to minus x2 omega square sine of omega. Now substitute this equation number 3, that is x1, equation number 4, that is value of x2, equation number 5, that is value of x1 double dot, and equation number 6, that is value of x2 double dot in equation number 1. So what will happen? So that is m1 into x1 double dot. So m1 x1 double dot. So it is positive. M1 x1 double dot. Now what is x1 double dot? It is minus x1 omega square sine of omega t. So that term become minus m1 x1 omega square sine of omega t plus k1 plus k2 into x1. So what is value of small x1? It is capital x1 sine of omega t. Again minus k2 into x2, small x2. Now small x2 is capital x2 sine of omega t. So that becomes minus k2 capital X2 sine of omega t. So again in that, if we take this sine omega t and sine omega t, these are common term, so that can be cancelled. So common and take to right hand side, it becomes 0. So the remaining terms are now minus m1 x1 omega square, k1 plus k2 into x1, minus k2 x2. Now take x1 common, capital X1 common. So what will happen? This term becomes minus m1 omega square. So this is minus m1 omega square plus x1 common. So remaining term is k1 plus k2. So minus m1 omega square plus k1 plus k2 into x1 minus k2 x2 is equals to 0. So this can be rearranged to this. Now this k1 plus k2, this positive term, so we are taking first minus m1 omega square. So k1 plus k2 minus m1 omega square into x1 is equals to this left hand term goes to this right hand side, so becomes k2 x2. So after that, we can again simplify. That is x1 upon x2 ratio. So this is x1, this is x2. So what will be that ratio? X1 upon x2 is equals to k2 upon this term. So x1 upon x2 is equals to k2 upon k1 plus k2 minus m1 omega. So this is your equation number 7. So what is your equation number 7? X1 upon X2 is equals to K2 upon K1 plus K2 minus M1 omega square. Similarly, we have to put the value of X2 double dot, X1 and X2 in equation number 2. Same. So what will happen? So your equation 2 is m2 x2 double dot. So your x2 double dot is, small x2 double dot is capital minus capital X2 omega square sine of omega 2. So that equation is minus M2 X2 omega square sine of omega t plus K2 plus K3 into small x2. Now small x2 is capital X3 sine of omega t minus K2 X1. Now what is value of small x1? It is capital X1 sine of omega t is equals to 0. So again in that equation also these two X2 term are constant. Again sine omega t, sine omega t, sine omega t gets cancelled. Now in that equation again X2 and X2, these two term are constant. So minus M2 omega square plus K2 plus K3 into X2 and this remaining term minus K2 X1 is equals to 0. Again same, this term goes to this side, so that becomes positive and we have to find out the ratio of X1 upon X2. So what is that ratio X1 upon X2? Now the, if this term goes to right hand side, so K2 X1, so what is X1 upon X2? This X1 goes to this side and X2 divided. So we get X1 upon X2 is equals to this term upon this K2 term. So K2 plus K3 minus M2 omega square upon K2. So this is your, from equation number 2, we get this ratio X1 upon X2. Now, for equation number 7 and equation number 8, if we see your equation number 7, this is equation number 7 and equation number 8. If we see these two equations, the left hand side terms are same. So X1 upon X2 are equal. So right hand side also terms are equals. So equating equation 7 and 8, we get K2 upon K1 plus K2 minus M1 omega square. So this term is same, is equals to this term. So K2 upon K1 plus K2 minus M1 omega square is equals to K2 plus K3 minus M2 omega square upon K2. Now take cross multiplication. Take cross multiplication. So what will happen? This bracket into this bracket. So that is K1 plus K2 minus M1 omega square into K2 plus K3 into minus M2 omega square is equals to K2 into this K2 cross multiplication. So after cross multiplying, what will happen? So this is your term. Now multiply each term to this second term. Now this is a plus b into b plus c, sorry, a plus b into c plus d. So only multiply. So first we have to multiply this k1 and k2 with this k2 and k3 and m2 omega. So what will happen? So k1 plus k2 into k2 plus k3. So this is your first term. What will say our second term? K1 plus K2 into minus M2 omega square. So minus K1 plus K2 into M2 omega square. So this is second term. Again, we have to multiply this minus M1 omega square with this term and this term. So minus M1 omega square into K2 plus K3. So that becomes minus M1 omega square K2 plus K3 and minus M1 omega square and this minus M2 omega square. So that becomes minus minus plus. So plus M1 M2 omega raised to 4. This omega square and this omega square. So omega raised to 4 is equals to K2 square. Again. Now. Again this K1 plus K2 multiply by this K2 plus K3. So again same K1 into this K2 plus K1 into K3. Similarly K1 into, K2 into K2. And K2 into K3. So that becomes K1, K2, K1, K3, K2, K3, any K2 square minus. Now, these two terms, there is common minus term. So minus is taken common. And another common is term also, that common term is your. So minus common. So these all are positive. So M1 omega square, K2 plus K3, M2 omega square, K1 plus K2 plus m1 m2 omega raised to 4 k2 square. Now this k2 square and this k2 square was cancel. Now we are starting with omega square omega raised to 4 term, then second term is omega square term, and third term is constant term. So we are rearranging these terms. So what will happen? So m1 m2 omega raised to 4, this is your first term. What is omega square term? So omega square term, there is also term omega square, there is also term omega square. So keep this common term outside. So minus m1 k2 plus k3 plus m2 k1 plus k2 into omega square. Plus these are cancel, this k2 square and this k2 square. So remaining terms are k1 k2 plus k2 k3 plus k1 k3. So these are the constant term is equals to 0. Now this equation, this we can say this is equation number star. Now from this equation, it is the quadratic equation in omega square. If your quadratic equation is your ax square plus bx plus c, but the quadratic equation is in omega square, so it has two values of omega square. Similarly, ax square plus bx plus c, it has two values. Similarly, omega square has two values. So these two, there are two positive values of omega and there are two negative values of omega. So we are taking only positive value, negative value we are not taking, this negative value. So these two positive values of omega will use two natural frequency, because 1 degree of freedom system having only one natural frequency and 2 degrees of freedom system having two natural frequencies. So there are two natural frequency, omega n1 and omega n2 for 2 degrees of freedom system. So now there are some special cases. So we'll start our special case, that is case number 1. Now what is your special case number 1? If both masses m1 and m2 are same, that is m1 is m2 is equals to m, and the spring k1 is equals to k2 is equals to k, and the value of k3 is equals to 0. This is your special case. So this is the diagram. K1, K2, both having same value, that is K. So we can take on this as K. This is also as K. So there are only two spring, K1 and K2, and K3 spring is, there is no K3 spring. And there are two masses. First M1, M2, and both having mass same, that is M. This having a mass also m. Now what is your equation? So if we see your equation, so your first term is m1 m2 omega raised to 4. Now m1 and m2 both are same, so m into m, that is m square into omega raised to 4. So this is your first term. Now second, M1 is again M. Now K3 is 0, so there is only term K2. So this is again K into M. That is K1 M1, K2 M1, that is K2 is K and M1 is also M. So K2, K into M. Plus, now K1 and K2, so this is again K plus, this is again K. So K plus K, 2K. And M2 is M. So 2K M. So km plus 2km into omega square plus, now k3 is 0, so this term cancel, this term cancel. So remaining term only k1 into k2, that is k into k, k square is equals to 0. what will happen? M square omega raised to 4 minus this km plus 2 km, that is 3 km, omega square into k square is equals to 0. Now divide by this m square. So what will happen? Omega raised to 4 minus 3 km upon m square. So that becomes 3 k upon m. This is 3 km upon m square. So 1 m get cancel. So it is 3 k upon m. Similarly, k square upon m square is equals to 0. So if we calculate the root of this equation, so root of equation is omega square because it is in omega raised to 4. So what is your root of equation? Minus b plus or minus square root of 4 a c upon twice a. So in that the value of b is minus 3k upon m. Now this whole term is divided by 2a, so this will be divided by 2a and this will in under root, or we can say this is divided by again 2a. So what will minus b upon 2a? So that is minus b minus, so minus minus plus, so 3k upon 2m. Now m ch value is 1, h value is 1, so minus minus plus, so 3k by 2m. This is your first, because minus b is minus minus plus, so 3k by m divided by twice a. Now what is twice a? A is 1, so remaining term is 2, so 3k upon 2 plus again b square minus 4ac. So what is b square? B square is minus minus plus, so 3 square is 9, so 9k square by m square. So this is b square minus 4. What is value of a? A is 1. And what is value of c? C is k square upon m square. K square upon m square. So denominator is same, so divided by m square. So 9k minus 5k square. 9k square minus 5k square, that become 5k square. And whole this term is in under root. So that becomes root 5 k by m. So root 5 k by m divided by twice a. Now what is value of a? A is 1, so it becomes 2. So square root of 5 by 2 k m. So these are the two positive value and two negative values are there. So if we simply calculate, we get omega square is equals to, now 3 by 2 is 5, 1.5, plus root 5 by 2 is 1.13, and this k by m is constant. So there is no square root, only k by m. So 1.5 plus or minus 1.13 k by m. Now in that, there are two positive value and two negative value. So there is one positive value and one negative value for omega square. So what is first positive value? So your first omega n square. So first omega n square is equals to what will? It is 1.5. minus 1.13, so that is becomes 0.37 into k by m. There is no square root, so into k by m. And second value is 1.5 plus 1.13, so that becomes 2.63 k by m. And what is square root of this? So 0.37 square root is 0.62 square root of k by m. And what is square root of this 2.63? It is 1.62 square root of k by m. So these are the two natural frequencies for the specimens. Next, we can find out a Mohr shapes also. Now, what is Mohr shapes and how we can find out the Mohr shapes? We will see. So your Mohr shapes, it is the motion of the system where every point in a system execute harmonic system with one natural frequency is called as principal mode of vibration or natural mode of vibration. It is called as principal mode of vibration or natural mode of vibration, where the motion of the system, where every point in the system execute harmonic motion with one natural frequency, either omega 1, that is only one natural frequency, and that one natural frequency is called as principal mode of vibration. So what is, so we'll start. So there are two equations for x1 upon x2. So first equation is this, equation number 7. And this is your second equation, that is equation number 8. We can use any one of these. So I will use this equation number 7. So from equation number 7, we know that x1 upon x2 is k2 upon k1 plus k2 minus m1 omega. So this is your equation. So x1 upon x2 is k2 upon k1 plus k2 upon m1 minus m1 omega square. Now what is the your special case? That is m1 is equals to m2 is equals to m and k1 is equals to k2 is equals to k. Now substitute. So what will happen? X1 upon x2. Now k2 value it is k. So k. Now this k1 plus this k2, that is k plus k2k minus m omega square. That is m1 value is m. Now Mohr shapes. Now what is your equation for Mohr shapes? So first x1 upon x2 is equals to k upon 2k minus m omega square. Now put, there are two values of omega square. One is omega n square and another value is omega n2 square. So put, first we have to put the value of omega square as omega n square. That is nothing but the 0.37 k by m. Now put that value. So what will happen? This is first value. So first Mohr shape. So x1 upon x2 1 is equals to k upon 2k minus m. Now what is value of omega square? We have to put the value of omega square as omega n square. So m into 0.37 k by m. So again this m and this m cancels. So k upon 2k minus 0.37 k. So that becomes k upon 1.63 k. Now k get cancelled. So 1 upon 1.63. So 1 upon 1.63, if we divide this, so that will becomes 0.614. So this is your first Mohr shape. So what is first Mohr shape? X1 upon x2 is equals to 0.614. Now similarly, we have to put the value of omega square as omega n2 square. What is value of omega n2 square? It is 2.63 k by m. Now x1 upon x2, k2. So k2 is k minus k1 plus k2 is 2k minus m. So only we have to change this. So 2.63 k by m. Now again m get cancelled. Again this k are common. So kk get cancelled. So what will happen? 1 upon 2 minus 2.63. So that becomes 1 upon minus 0.63. So that value becomes minus 1.587. So this is second Mohr shapes. So this equation number 10 and equation number 11, which defines the way these two masses M1 and F2 are moved, and these are called as Moore shapes equations. These are called as Moore shapes equation. So first ratio, so there are two ratios, x1 upon x2. So for first ratio, the amplitude of two masses is positive 0.614, which means two motions are in phase because it is in positive. So two masses moves in up or down together. So with frequency omega n1. This Moore shapes has frequency omega n1. So if we, and second ratio, if you take second ratio, so the second ratio, it is minus 1.587, which means two masses are out of phase. That is when one mass moves up, another mass moves in down or vice versa. So for that, x1 upon x2 is minus 1.587 with frequency omega 2. Now we have to draw the Moore shapes. So how will you draw the Moore shapes? Now first Moore shapes is x1 upon x2 is equals to 0.614. Now in that, assume some value. So we are going to assume x2 as one unit. If we assume x2 as one unit, then we get x1 as 0.614 unit, because x1 is equals to 0.614 x2. So we have assumed. Now your figure is like this, your main figure. This is your fixed mass. This is your first mass, M1, and this is your another mass, M2. So there are two masses. Now displacement x1 and displacement x2. Now x2 is one unit in positive direction. So if this is positive direction, so right hand side is positive direction. So x2 is positive one unit. Again x1 becomes positive 0.164 unit. So this is again positive 164 unit. Now in that, both are in same direction. That is, both are in phase. But for this second Moore shapes with frequency omega n2. So what is this? x1 upon x2 is equals to minus 1.587. Now in that condition, if x2 is one unit in positive direction, then x1 will be the minus 1.587, means in negative direction. So I will take this one unit is in opposite direction, that is minus sign. So minus one unit. So in this direction, so x1 is 1.587. It is in opposite direction. So these are in out of. So this is x1 and this is x2. And this is your original position. So this is the first Moore shape and second Moore shapes. So this is first Moore shape at omega n for x1 upon x2 is equals to 0.614. And this is the second Moore shape at omega n2. For that, the Moore shape x1 upon x2 of second is equals to minus 1.587. So this is the diagram for this special case. Similarly, we can have number of special cases for that system. So this is all about your today's lecture. Thank you.